play McDonald's.
Remember the America's Cup races last September? You'll recall a national shock when Australia won. Well, another sailing confrontation is shaping up between Australia and the United States, this time at the Olympics. And Bob Brown, you've been following that.
Yes, I have, Hugh. And this time the confrontation is between sailboats of a different kind, catamarans. Even though they are part of the Olympics now, cats, as they're often called, were disdained for years, except by the people who sailed them.
Yeah, I guess their main appeal is speed and simplicity.
And a low cost as well, because for a few thousand dollars you can get a very fast boat. For instance, the yachts that sailed in the America's Cup averaged less than 10 miles per hour, but a catamaran and a good wind can approach 30 miles per hour, and it's all in the way they're designed.
These craft are studies in symmetry. They are the fastest sailing boats ever made. But their design and construction is so plain that they rest almost unobtrusively along a shoreline. Just as intriguing as their simple and efficient design is the unusual history behind these sailing boats. This patent was recorded April 10, 1877, and begins, "Be it known that I, Nathaniel G. Hershoff, have invented certain new and useful improvements relating to sailing vessels by which I can obtain great speed and stability." Hershoff, with the zeal of a Jules Verne character plotting a journey to the moon or around the world in 80 days, had designed the Amaryllis. He was unaware, perhaps, that Polynesians had sailed similar craft centuries before, and that he had simply reinvented the world's fastest sailing boat, the catamaran. In any event, the idea that Nathaniel G. Hershoff claimed as his own never caught on in his time. Traditional American yachting circles in the 19th century wouldn't hear of a simple boat with pontoons that made two hulls instead of one.
They always looked on catamarans a long time ago as black sheep. I think a real problem was that an inexpensive boat could go out there and blow off their big expensive boats, and they didn't think that was very gentlemanly and didn't like it, and the easy way to take care of it was don't come around anymore.
This is Hobie Alter. In a sense, he helped give the catamaran its place in the sun 100 years after Nathaniel Hershoff had failed. Alter was a champion California surfer who also manufactured surfboards for a living. And when he finally got tired of it, he found he enjoyed sailing on an old-style heavy catamaran of a type that had never quite caught on with the public.
I liked that, except it took six people to drag it up and down the beach, and once they dragged it up down the beach, you got half ownership in that sucker. So you got to take them all for a ride. And I mean, my friends, myself, we all talked, wouldn't it be nice to have a small catamaran we could just drag in and out of the water and sail it by ourselves? And, you know, some people study to be doctors and that, and I think living on the beach and the surroundings they're in, I guess maybe you learn to be a good player.
And so Alter invented the Hobie Cat, a catamaran so simple and light you can sail it right off the beach by yourself or with a friend. He gave me a ride on one of his models in the Pacific Ocean near his beachfront home. You sit on a trampoline that connects the two pontoons, the hulls. They're made of fiberglass, the frame is aluminum, the sails are Dacron. And those are among the reasons why the boat is so fast. It's light. Here's another reason. Look at the two hulls. Imagine they were created by splitting a conventional boat in half and spreading the halves apart for greater balance. If these two hulls were one, they'd have to be heavier and sit deeper in the water to maintain their balance. As it is, they can virtually ride the waves, so there's less water resistance. One of the results has been a huge increase in catamaran ownership nationwide over the last decade, which has made millions not only for Hobie Alter, but for other manufacturers. There are an estimated 250,000 cat sailors in the country. And on any weekend, spring, summer, fall, or winter, there is a catamaran regatta somewhere in the United States. This one was at Lake Havasu, Arizona. Sometimes, for promotional purposes, Hobie himself comes to sail around the race course marked off by buoys. He also helped move sailing out of the male-dominated yacht club world. Women sail these boats in competition.
If we geared all of our sports only for the winner, then pretty soon we'd have only the winner sailing around in circles out there by himself and no one else to enjoy the whole thing. So you gotta make a nice party. That was my whole goal in life. The only reason I worked at all was so that I could have time off and play.
Hobie Alter represented a quantum leap from that failed 19th century catamaran designer Nathaniel Hirschoff. And just since Hobie started for fun, there is now a new generation of American catamaran sailors who are so skilled and involved in the sport that they sail in competitions around the world. This is Randy Smythe of Huntington Beach, California. He earns his living as a sailmaker. And working with his partner, Jay Glazer, he is to catamaran sailing what Jack Nicklaus has been to golf, a competitor with such natural, instinctive ability that at his peak, he is unstoppable. A two-time world champion.
You start out, I guess, like most anybody may, just in the summer, just sailing around and crashing into things and tipping over and having fun. But the first time for me, I guess, was I entered my first race, had a little 12-foot catamaran, and all these people I was kind of intimidated by, and I went out and won. The end of the regatta, I go, gee, maybe I do know what I'm doing.
How old were you then?
I think 10 or 11.
Smythe, who has been beating sailors of all ages since those elementary school days, is 29 now. And a few weeks ago, he was attending a briefing prior to the U.S. Olympic trials in Long Beach. He was the odds-on favorite to captain the U.S. team in what will be only the third Olympics to allow a catamaran class in yachting competition. And just as the America's Cup became a classic yachting showdown between the U.S. and Australia before the innovative Australian team broke the 132-year American victory string, the Olympics are also shaping up as an intriguing matchup between those two countries in catamaran sailing for similar reasons, with Randy Smythe as one of the focal points. Smythe and his sailing team member Jay Glazer had seemed unbeatable until the Australians took his world championship away from him using an innovative technique for catamarans, bending the mast in a way that allows more air to strike the mainsail for greater speed.
We were sort of devastated, really, by the Australians. They just came out of nowhere, pretty much, and just kind of walked all over us at first. Now we're catching back up to where they are, or hopefully very close to their level of expertise.
Before he got his chance to take another crack at the Australians, Smythe had competition from a number of addicted American cat sailors, many of whom had put their careers on hold to challenge the team of Smythe and Glazer for the one spot available in the Olympics. Physicist Mike Zutek, whose acquaintance with the winds extends to his design of these prototype energy-harnessing windmill blades for NASA.
You are the central nervous system of this craft that's got fins in the water like a fish, and it's got sails in the air like a bird, and you are the one who controls it all, this special kind of creature. You have to play the thing, it's like a symphony. You're trying to get all these things going just right, and there's a certain delicacy of approach that's required to sail a boat like that.
Zutek's description wound up being tailor-made for Smythe and Glazer, who breezed through the Olympic trials without losing a race, qualifying for a shot at a gold medal and another chance at the Australians with a perfect score. Watch the speed Smythe achieves in these Olympic-class catamarans, called tornadoes, approaching 30 miles an hour. And the sensation of sailing that fast, driven by an invisible force, has been compared to free-fall parachuting. It's not unusual to see one of the two hulls of the craft fly into the air. The sailors hook to a trapeze that allows them to stretch out over the ocean to balance the cat. Smythe and Glaser hardly speak to each other when they sail. It is an intuitive art as well as a technical one, sensing shifts in the winds, looking ahead for glassy patches of ocean that warn of places where the wind has died.
You're forever just trying to ooch every little bit of boat speed you can possibly get out of the boat by tweaking the sails, by moving your weight, by steering around waves. The infinitesimal little changes that you're doing are actually beyond even the detail of the computer to analyze.
And remember, these Olympic-class boats employ the same basic design and size that weekend sailors enjoy. And you can imagine now why that simplicity fascinated the 19th century inventor we told you about, Nathaniel Hirshaw, who turned out to be 100 years ahead of his time. But even though his catamaran was booted out of an 1876 race when it sailed rings around expensive yachts, he continued to insist that a half day's sail in a cat would spoil anyone for the old fashioned way.
Incidentally, Hugh, even though the chief competitors in these Olympic trials were male, the event is open to everyone, male, female, or a mixed team.
Is age a factor at either end of the spectrum?
Well, apparently not.